Welcome back to Movies TV Mad. Of course, you can follow me on Twitter at Movies TV Mad. And welcome to Saturday's edition of the dceu Daily. So, Jared Leto wants Warner Brothers to release the Suicide Squad David Ayer cut. That's what streaming services are for. Exclusive from Variety. And after we read this article together, we're going to go into this. Should HBO Max partially be a place for director's cuts? I think so. Not just with superhero movies, but lots of works from years gone by. They could be reworked. There's money in this. Zack Snyder's Justice League Snyder Cut proves this. This is by Solomi Halu of Variety. Jared Leto has spoken. He says he thinks it's time that Warner Brothers released David Ayer's cut of Suicide Squad. Absolutely. Why not? The actor who played the Joker in the 2016 film told Variety's Mark Malkin on Thursday night at the Los Angeles premiere of House of Gucci at the Academy Museum. Why wouldn't they? Why wouldn't they? I mean, that's what streaming's for, right? Ayer concurred with Leto on Twitter exactly what streaming is for. If you own IP and you have a mandate to monetize it from your shareholders, that's exactly what you do. He wrote, tagging Warner Brothers' parent company, AT&T. Why has he done this? Because it was AT&T and Warner Brothers who greenlit the Snyder Cut. Without AT&T owning this company, let me be clear here, this would never have happened. It was us in the Release the Snyder Cut community, sending them letters, sending them emails, sending their workers flowers at their offices. That really hit them hard. They knew there was a consumer base for the Snyder Cut. So, now and again, when we do these Restore the Snyderverse, you know, things, why not, you know, send a thank you to AT&T for supporting us in our aim to release the Snyder Cut and restore the Snyderverse. Now, let me be clear here. I know that Discovery are buying this company, but let's be clear again, AT&T will still be majority shareholders. Now, it will be David Zaslav and Discovery running this company, but AT&T can influence what Discovery do. So always remember AT&T released the Snyder Cut and always tag them, even after Discovery take over, because things can happen. It was AT&T who did this. They won't have much authority, but they will have an influence. I think a very interesting tactic for the Restore the Snyderverse community going forward. And when I talk about Restore the Snyderverse, I'm not just talking about Justice League 2 and Justice League 3. I'm talking about Make the Batfleck movie. I'm talking about Release the Ayer Cut. So David said exactly what streaming is for. If you own IP and you have a mandate to monetize it from your shareholders, that's exactly what you do. He obviously tags AT&T, and he quote tweets Variety saying Jared Leto says release the Ayer Cut. The very article I'm reading now. Ayer first confirmed the existence of his cut of the film in a statement in July. Since then, fans have rallied to see Ayer's version, which Ayer alleges is significantly different from the studio cut that debuted to negative reviews. Ayer has occasionally commented since then, and on November the 10th posted to his Instagram story a look at an alternative look at Jared Leto's Joker, featuring a dramatic drawn-on smile and the words ha-ha-ha written where his eyebrows should be. Leto isn't the first actor involved with the IP to publicly state his support of the Ayer Cut. Margot Robbie, John Cena and Joel Kinnaman made similar remarks at the August premiere of The Suicide Squad, James Gunn's 2021 follow-up to Ayer's film. I think that's all a very complicated situation that I'm probably not responsible for, said Robbie, who plays Harley Quinn in both Ayer's and Gunn's films. I want to talk about, briefly, Margot Robbie. It's interesting, isn't it? When you get SJWs writing live-action Harley Quinn, we see what we get. When we see a non-SJW like Ayer writing and directing Harley Quinn, you get something actually really special, even in the theatrical release. Interesting. I would want to see the cut of every movie I've been a part of that I've never seen. The funny thing is that when you're an actor, not when you're a producer, as an actor, sometimes I don't see it until half the country has seen it. You don't really get to see the different iterations along the way unless you're a producer. John Cena, who plays Peacemaker in Gunn's film, added, "It's in a company's best interest to listen to their audience, and if it's something that's so in demand and they've got it, why not? Yeah, why not? You always want to see the director's vision," said Joel Kinnaman, who plays Colonel Rick Flagg in both films. And during an appearance on the Just for Variety podcast in June, Kinnaman told Malkin that he was disappointed with Suicide Squad. "I thought the first 40 minutes of the film were fucking great, and then there were conflicting visions and it just didn't end up being what we all hoped it was. It didn't feel like the movie that we hoped we were going to make." And that's the article, so it's very, very interesting. But as I said earlier, before I started reading this article, this actually goes beyond the air cut, and of course I'm here to fight for everything, as you know. Since my little channel was born, I was fighting for the Snyder Cut, Restore the Snyderverse, yes. I criticise Zack Snyder sometimes. I believe he and Ray Fisher's stance against Warner Brothers and Fisher's stance against Walter Hamada really damaged the fight to restore the Snyderverse, because I think the Snyderverse was going to be restored before they started trying to get some revenge. I really, really do. But anyway, we are where we are. I love Zack as a director and a person, by the way. Ray Fisher is a great actor. I'm not a big fan of his personally, but he's a great cyborg. A great Victor Stone, no question about that. So we want all of these things. And, you know, as these actors and people are saying, why not? Why the hell not? Zack Snyder's Justice League Snyder Cut has done so well for the studio. They know this. It shouldn't be a case of us fighting and trying to convince them to do this, because there's money in it for them. Something very wrong was done to Justice League. Something very wrong was done to Zack's and David's entire DCEU vision. It should be David who did Birds of Prey and Gotham City Sirens and the Suicide Squad sequel. There's no reason David shouldn't have been allowed to continue. Well, there is, because they were chasing after the Marvel Studios dream and they thought they could do it in a lazy way. And I think I actually wanted to talk about the inception of the DCEU, because I suppose in a lot of ways DCEU live action, or DC live action, even pre-DCEU, was heavily criticised. The Green Lantern movie, Superman Returns, are issues within that, although I love both of those movies, and I think Superman Returns has great elements to it. And in fact, if you talk about a director's cut, there's some of us still out there, including me and many Superman Returns fans, who want to see a director's cut. Of course, that's somewhat problematic now with the revelations that came out a few years back about Bryan Singer, and I get that. Again, studio interference interfered with Bryan Singer's vision. Bryan Singer shot this beautiful Return to Krypton sequence. It's on the Blu-ray. It's on YouTube. It's pretty much finished. The CGI needs sensational. Maybe it needs touching up a little bit. No pun intended, considering this is Bryan Singer involved. Too soon? A bit crossing the line there? Probably. Sorry about that. But yeah, the Return to Krypton sequence is amazing. It really is. And I've always said that sequence should have been pre-opening title sequence. It should have been. You see that sequence, you see the opening credit titles, which pretty much are Superman and his ship going back to Earth after being, you know, in outer space searching for Krypton for around 5 years. The Return to Krypton sequence is the whole essence of the fucking piece. The essence of the piece is he's been off-world for 5 years. And the question is, does the world need Superman? That's what Lois Lane's, you know, Pulitzer Prize award-winning article is saying. And it's a question in the real world, we were saying, considering, you know, before Superman Returns, it was 20 years since we had a Superman film. Ironically, Superman 4, another kind of destroyed DC movie. So it's pre-DCEU. These people were doing it a long time ago. Richard Donner's vision for Superman 2, interfered with by the Sulkinds so they could penny pinch. And, you know, this has been happening a long time with DC live action movies. And it's incredible the Donner situation is so identical to the Zack Snyder situation. But that wasn't what the Donner situation isn't WB's fault, it's Sulkinds' fault. But they should never have allowed Superman to crawl away to a set of producers in the first place. But credit to the Sulkinds, they had the bravery and passion to invest big money in a Superman movie. And the first one's great, but that's because of Richard Donner's passion and bravery to fight the Sorkinds on every level. It's because people who inject money into films obviously need to have a bit of a say because it's their finances, but ultimately they don't understand stories. And when they interfere too much, this is what goes wrong. And Chloe Zhao's Eternals is a great example. The stuff that Chloe's trying to do is great. It's the moment where Faith gets involved and injects the humour and, you know, kind of the Easter eggs and things like that and name droppings. That's where it becomes overstuffed. And there are a lot of characters in Eternals, and it's difficult to fit so many characters. The Eternals are a big group of people, and it's difficult. And I think you do an Eternals trilogy and you feed them in slowly, that's probably a better thing. I don't know if we'll get that Eternals trilogy. I hope so, and I hope Chloe gets to do it, because I really enjoyed the Eternals movie. I like the way it's got room to breathe. It's a really interesting attempt at a superhero movie. I don't think it's a classic movie or anything like that. I think if you left Chloe alone to do whatever she wanted, I think that would have been a beautiful movie. We would have been looking at another Dune. And credit to Warner Brothers learning their lesson, allowing Villeneuve to make his own movie. He's upset with them over Day and Date, but he's credited them a lot for the creative freedom he had on the movie. So they are learning their lessons. Now, the bigger talking point here is to learn their lessons in terms of director's cuts, because there's so many films under the Warner Brothers banner that you could do this with. Now, there's two types of director's cuts. There's the ones that had considerably, you know, amount of narrative and sequences cut off, like the Snyder Cut. I mean, there's 4 hour of fucking footage in that movie. It's a different movie. There's also kind of things that, you know, in the end will just be different sequences shot in different angles. I'm not particularly interested in that, but I still think there's money in it for the studios. And if they can allow things like the Ayer cut to come out and they want to do things like that, why not? I mean, director's cuts have been a thing for many, many years now, where you can buy director's cuts of films, as I say, shot in different angles, not necessarily a new narrative like the Snyder Cut, but I'm sure there's a place for them. And I look, David Ayer's Ayer cut, there's money to be made from it. Not the Snyder Cut money, but there's certainly interesting things. There's things that he wanted to do and Snyder wanted him to do to kind of connect the dots to Snyder's dceu arc that ultimately Geoff Johns and co didn't allow him to do. But there was a lot of fear, because the motivations of starting the dceu was to make money, was to chase the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But it's interesting, again, when we look at this, Kevin Feige, you know, came in and decided to do a kind of television serial of the Marvel Cinematic Universe. It's now TV, streaming, and cinematic, right? So what Kevin Feige does is he looks at the MCU like a television series. It's like he's the showrunner. And I think like something like the DCEU could do with a showrunner. And hopefully, you know, Walter Hamada is that showrunner. I'm not sure about that yet. We'll have to wait and see with the four movies we get in cinematic form, and Batgirl and Blue Beetle and Peacemaker, and see if we're getting that interconnectivity. Because if we're not, because that's what audiences want to see. We can talk all day about real movies, but the films that are making money today are the ones with a connective television serial arc and kind of, you know, interconnectivity to them. And it's interesting though, because Daniel Craig's James Bond had the same thing, didn't it? Casino Royale started off this arc, this connective tissue, and they didn't execute it very well, which is a shame, but the idea's there. And I mean, you know, No Time to Die is what, about 700 million globally now, so it's done very well. People still love Bond, and I think they need to look at Bond, start Bond again, tell us a bit about his childhood. What I would do with Bond, actually, I would create a streaming series that connects to the movies. So I would show a young teenage James Bond series where we see the backstory, instead of his parents, like in Ian Fleming's books, dying in a rock climbing accident, they're murdered by a group, by a person. Young teenage James Bond goes on the run, and it's a 5-year plan. And this streaming series is connected to the theatrical movies. But we jump a many years when Bond's now 30 years old. And some of that story is left to the television series, and they fill in the blanks, if you like, but it's all connected. The people who murdered Bond's family are connected, are the overarching threat of that era of James Bond. And I think that's how you could do James Bond, because I know I'm talking about James Bond here, and this is the DCEU Daily, but just one more thing about Bond. We cannot have the James Bond we had in the 60s, 70s and 80s. That's gone. We don't live in that kind of world now. But is it offensive for Bond to be sarcastic, to be, you know, fun, to have personality? Because I think No Time to Die lacked that. So, so serious. Just a film that runs and runs and runs. But back to the DC Extended Universe. So they were chasing after Marvel Studios. So instead of getting like a TV showrunner kind of situation going, they brought in Christopher Nolan, who probably doesn't even like comic books. I know he did Batman, but he's not really a fan, is he? Let's be honest. So this is a man who knows jack shit about any comics, DC Comics included, and they gave him this Godfather role to run the DC, you know, Extended Universe. What happens? He brings another auteur in, because he's an auteur. So what's he going to do? He's going to bring an auteur in who's got very, very kind of definite, you know, opinions about superheroes and how they should be portrayed in movies. So he does something very interesting and compelling, but unfortunately, you can't chase the Marvel Studios' success that way. They realise this when it's too late. I mean, they saw the reaction to BVS. This made them nervous, and this is why they went back and changed the Suicide Squad. They're kind of, it's like the coyote chasing Roadrunner and never catching him. That's what WB chasing the Marvel Studios success is. That's why they redid Justice League and it became Justice League, because they thought they could cheat quickly, have a few jokes, you know, bright color palettes, and they would get there. And of course, anyone who knows anything about these things, and you don't even have to work in the industry, it was obvious this wasn't going to work. And even now, you know, Snyder's gone, they're chasing that mantle again. We've got four movies. No, we've got six movies next year, including, no, I think seven movies, including the three. Oh, no, because Peacemaker's a series, isn't it? Yeah, so we've got about six movies, including Blue Beetle and Batgirl next year, and the four releasing through the theatrical system. And so they're still chasing after that formula. The question is, will it be successful? And everything, it remains on the Flash movie, because that's what they're using to reboot the entire universe. I would have just started from scratch after Justice League. I would have binned the DCEU and started again. Because as I said the other day, and what I've said many times, the DCEU lacks consumer confidence. You can see that from the box office for Birds of Prey, The Suicide Squad, who knows how popular Wonder Woman 84 was, not very from what I can see. So really, ever since Shazam, no, I mean, it's interesting, isn't it? Because Shazam was relatively successful, Aquaman was relatively successful, the Joker movie was definitely successful, but then we went into these movies where we've had this kind of lull. As I say, The Suicide Squad didn't do very well. A pretty good film, but I wouldn't say it's the best thing ever. It doesn't have to be the best thing ever. Everything doesn't have to be the best thing ever. Even though the generation and era of consumer expects that. That's the problem. Everything you do in a franchise has to be better than the last thing. So it's interesting. It is like the coyote chasing the Roadrunner. And can WB and DC finally catch the Roadrunner? It's very difficult. As I say, if you start from scratch with a DC Extended Universe after Justice League, you just say, it didn't work. It didn't work. We made mistakes. People didn't latch on to what Snyder was doing. It's a shame. We've done some things we shouldn't have done. We've made mistakes. We're starting again. So you start from a very first movie and you create an arc. And if you want to make it lighter, you make it lighter. Whatever you think is going to appeal to the broader audience. Because after all, that's where the money is. Now that will upset my fellow Snyder fans, but I'm just being honest from a business perspective, and it's nothing I haven't said before. So what you're doing, you're chasing your own tail, because now you're rebooting the entire universe. And that's a question for today's DCEU Daily, and I want to see in the comments down below. Can the Flash movie and I know this is going to sound a bit jerky, save the DCEU, and I hate that term, but can it make it an attractive proposition to, you know, the mainstream consumer? Can it attract people? Like, can it become an MCU that's so popular, it doesn't matter what piece of shit you put out there, people embrace it? And believe you me, the MCU have had a lot of shit, but people just embrace it. Even if there's slight criticisms, the money's still there, and people get so excited. And as I say with the MCU has earned the right to do Spider-Man No Way Home. Now they're giving the fans a really exciting movie, because as I've already said as well, Spider-Man No Way Home is the Flash movie. Spider-Man No Way Home is going... Spider-Man No Way Home and Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness are going to change the MCU forever. And they're going to bring different universes as one. Now, this is exactly what the DCEU are attempting to do. But should we trust them? Because they've done such a magnificent job thus far in creating a connective universe, right? Can they do it? Because basically, Feige and the MCU and Marvel Studios are under no pressure with Spider-Man No Way Home and Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. They're doing this in two movies. Basically, there's a chapter one here and a chapter two, where Flashpoint is one movie. They're using the Barry Allen Flashpoint story to reboot the entire universe. Can they do it? It's very ambitious. You certainly would trust the people who are working over at Marvel Studios more thus far than the people working at the DCEU. And people don't like me saying this, but Christina Hodgson's writing this very important movie. And I like Andy Muschietti, but he's not very experienced. It's interesting, but the parallels are there, because the people who made Spider-Man Homecoming and Spider-Man Far From Home are involved in this big movie as well. So it's a similar situation, but the differences are that Marvel Studios are under no pressure here. This is just part of Phase 4. They're changing things up. They're bringing the multiverse in. They're making the multiverse canon, as the DCEU and Walter Hamada are attempting to do. So both of these can be successful. It doesn't have to be a case of, one's going to be successful and one's not. But you've got to look at, you know, you're only as good as your last game, right? That's what they say in football, or in soccer, as you Americans call it. So let's look at our last game. James Gunn's The Suicide Squad isn't a bad movie. It's pretty good and enjoyable, in fact. But it didn't make much money. Yeah, theatrically, anyway. And then we've spoken about Birds of Prey, a very problematic movie that didn't make much money. Wonder Woman 1984 creatively saw problems between the director and the studio yet again. Patty Jenkins seems to have a lot of problems with, you know, studio heads, because they've seen something that a lot of people seem to refuse, that Patty Jenkins is just not a very good writer-director. And as I said yesterday, and it was yesterday, wasn't it, that she shouldn't be making the third Wonder Woman film. This Wonder Woman franchise needs saving. And Patty Jenkins and Gal Gadot and Linda Carter are not going to do that. Gal Gadot's a great Wonder Woman, but she should keep to playing Wonder Woman and not being interested in how Wonder Woman is shaped, because she doesn't, you know... Gal Gadot was a model, became an actress. And she's a good actress, a solid actress. And I like her as Wonder Woman. No, scratch that. I love her as Wonder Woman. It doesn't mean I want her being involved with the script work or the story, but having a producer's credit in Wonder Woman 84, which, by the way, I think is very telling to how bad that movie is. And Gal must take her share of the responsibility, as Patty Jenkins and Geoff Johns should as well. And so... It's very interesting. We started off with Release the Air Cut and how, you know, Jared Leto is saying, why not? Isn't that what streaming's for? And he's right. He's right at the end of the day. The HBO Max can be a portion, can have a portion of the director's cuts. And that's great. And people will come for that. You know, the Snyder Cut has started something here. There's so many versions of movies that could be reworked, give you alternate endings. It would be nuts, right? Doesn't Seven have about 3 or 4 alternate endings? Do it. I'm not sure what studio made that film, but just for an example, there's a new element of creativity, because like it or not, We're not in the era of making good standalone movies anymore. This is where we are now. The movie franchises, the internet, where everyone has got a megaphone talking about what they love and what they don't love so much. Exactly what I've been doing today on today's DCEU Daily. So of course, there's a place for director's cuts on streaming. And by the way, do it. Have a section on HBO Max. And yeah, we must see David Ayer's Suicide Squad, because it connects to the Snyder Cut as well. And it's just a shame. Do I think we will eventually have an Ayer cut? Yes, I do. I thought we were further down the road with this than we were because of the way David was talking. He has said that exciting things are happening. So I do believe we will see the Ayer cut. I think next year. And I think this will be great. And there's so many fights to fight still within the DCEU. And here's another thing, from the Warner Brothers point of view, because Warner Brothers Pictures never wanted to release the Snyder Cut. As I said on the top of the show, that was AT&T, and credit to them. They went after the money. But by the way, it doesn't matter that they went after the money. AT&T made a great business decision in releasing the Snyder Cut. And they could make a great business decision again. As I say, AT&T are going nowhere. They're going to stick to running the cable and wireless section of their company and allow Zaslav. Zaslav's like a troubleshooter, if you like. That's why he's here. And we were hearing yesterday from Variety that deal nearly broke down in April, but I think in June or something, they came to some agreements because Zaslav wanted full control and AT&T didn't want to give it to him. And ultimately, AT&T were in deep shit. They had no idea how to run a studio. They were doing it blindly. They were bullshitting it. But there's a lot of things AT&T and Jason Kilar did very, very well, and John Stankey. Not everything. They have made mistakes. You know, blindsiding an entire industry and announcing a day and date means you make enemies of everyone in the industry. You don't want to make enemies of people in this industry because, you know, I've seen it. I spent 6 months in Hollywood. I know how nasty they can be if you do something they don't like. They have an ethos in Hollywood, and it's about the theatrical system. And if you publicly, you know, give that system the finger, they don't like it. And there's certainly money for blockbusters in the theatrical system. But as we can see, since COVID, we can see films coming out for rent on streaming services very quickly, like Apple, Amazon, things like that. I mean, I hired No Time to Die yesterday, and I've got another, 35 hours to watch it as many times as I want. I fancy the rewatch. But it's still in cinemas in some countries as well. So things are going to come on streaming on your television set a lot quicker. So yeah, why not? Why not do this? Why not release the Ayer cut? Let's fix what bad things were done so we can move on. Now, if they, as I suggested, if they just started again with the DC Extended Universe, and, you know, after Justice League, they wouldn't have this problem. We've released the Snyder Cut or released the Ayer Cut. It would be a different situation. Yes, people would still be clamoring to bring Zack back and fighting for the Snyder Cut. But ultimately, they would have been under less pressure to do it. But once you do something like this, once you make these decisions in the entertainment industry and the entire public know, thanks to Zack Snyder exposing them, by the way, and it was Zack Snyder who manipulated the whole release, the Snyder Cut thing, and people still don't understand that. He was so very, very clever in what he did. And David Ayer is trying his best. I think he's doing a good job. I don't think he's doing the I'm trying to say that word and I can't say that word. That devious thing, that I can't say it. There's a word beginning with M. Never mind. Snyder was very devious and very good with what he did. He was leaking stuff online from the very beginning, before he even ever started on Vera. And this is how it all started, the Iris West scene when Barry saves her. That was leaked out. Who do you think leaked that out? Zack Snyder. Of course he did. He probably got someone else to do it so his hands didn't get dirty. That's how the whole thing started. So, you know, these things can be done if you're smart. Zack Snyder beat the system. I can't say that word, so I'm not going to bother. So, yeah, why not? Why not? We should be able to see, you know, David Ayer's Suicide Squad. It would be a great thing. And I think it's a great... I haven't seen it, but I'm hearing it's certainly a marked improvement. A very different movie. I don't know if it would be a hard R, But certainly there would be a lot more violence and the story would be a lot more grittier too. Warner Brothers became afraid because of everybody's reactions to Man of Steel and Batman vs. Superman. And even the Suicide Squad film that they messed around with was destroyed by critics, but it still made a hell of a lot of money. So, out of fear, the Snyder's vision for the DC Extended Universe changed very, very quickly. And there's a lesson to be learnt here. If you want an auteur to run your franchise, then you've got to give them creative freedom. If you want a franchise made by committee, like Kevin Feige's doing over at Marvel Studios, then do it and don't involve auteurs. This has been the DCEU Daily. I admit, your host with the most. Just ask your girlfriends and your wives. Like, share, subscribe, hit the notification bell so you never miss this perfection. Comment down below, and I'll see you again tomorrow with even more DCEU Daily. Until then, goodbye.